risking their security or facing more abuse. The indictment also alleges other acts of violence undertaken by Combs and others, including violence against witnesses to his abuse, kidnapping, and arson. The indictment alleges that on more than one occasion, Combs carried or brandished firearms to intimidate and threaten victims and witnesses. Now, Combs did not do this all on his own. As I mentioned, Combs has been charged with RICO conspiracy. He used his business and employees of that business and other close associates to get his way. Those individuals allegedly included high-ranking supervisors in the business, personal assistants, security staff, and household staff. The indictment alleges that those individuals facilitated the freak-offs. They booked the hotel rooms and stocked them with the supplies, including drugs, baby oil, personal lubricant, extra linens, and lighting. When the hotel rooms got damaged, they helped clean it up. They arranged for victims and commercial sex workers to travel for the freak-offs, and they delivered large quantities of cash to Combs to pay for the commercial sex workers. The indictment also alleges that they helped Combs cover up his crimes. During the March 2016 incident at the LA hotel that I mentioned earlier, a member of the hotel security staff intervened, and Combs attempted to bribe the staff member with a stack of cash to make sure that what happened was kept quiet. And as the indictment alleges, in late 2023, after public allegations were made about Combs' crimes, he and others pressured witnesses and victims to stay silent, including by making phone calls to witnesses and victims and giving them a false narrative of what they had experienced. And as alleged, Combs used others to help conceal his abuse by monitoring and preventing victims from leaving a location in order to hide their injuries, or by locating and contacting a victim who had attempted to flee. As part of this investigation, in March of this year, special agents from HSI executed search warrants at Combs' residences in Miami and Los Angeles. They also executed a warrant for Combs' electronic devices. During those searches, agents seized evidence of the crimes charged in this indictment. They seized firearms and ammunition, including three defaced AR-15s and a large-capacity drum magazine. They also seized evidence of the freak-offs, electronic devices that contain images and videos of the freak-offs with multiple victims. And they seize cases and cases of the kinds of personal lubricant and baby oil that Combs' staff allegedly used to stock hotel rooms for the freak-offs, more than 1,000 bottles altogether. Here are some of the items that we recovered during the searches. As you can see here, this is a drum magazine, large capacity, and it contains, I believe, 59 rounds. I mentioned as well, we recovered three AR-15s. This is a close-up shot of one of the AR-15s, and you can see right here, the serial number has been thoroughly defaced. Another picture of more ammunition and parts of two AR-15s right there. Now, I want to be clear about two things. First, this office is determined to investigate and prosecute anyone who engages in sex trafficking, no matter how powerful or wealthy or famous you may be. No one should doubt our commitment on that. A year ago, Sean Combs stood in Times Square and was handed a key to New York City. Today, he's been indicted and will face justice in the Southern District of New York. Second, we are not done. This investigation is ongoing, and I encourage anyone with information about this case to come forward and to do it quickly. Anyone with information can call 1-877-4-HSI-TIP. I want to express my deep appreciation for the victims and witnesses who have used their voices and helped bring this criminal conduct to light. We would not be here without them. I also want to thank the dedicated case agents on the HSI Trafficking in Person Squad in New York. They have been with us since day one and have worked tirelessly on this investigation. They will continue to be invaluable partners to us. I also want to thank the incredible agents and analysts Chrissy Slavik, Madison Slicer, and Mitzi Steiner, and their supervisors, Jamie Backlinder and Jacqueline Kelly. They are members of the Civil Rights Unit in our criminal division. We created the Civil Rights Unit when I became U.S. Attorney. I'm deeply proud of their work on this and so many other cases. I'll now take some questions. Eric Katursky.
Describes an aggressive, open, violent, hedonistic abuse that you say was recurrent and widely known. Why did it take law enforcement so long to intervene? How many women were victimized by Sean Combs, and how many others were involved?
Well, our investigation is ongoing. We are committed to bringing justice to everyone who's been victimized by the defendant. I can't tell you why it took so long. I think the better focus is on the fact that we are here today. And we are committed to making sure that justice is done. Next question.
Julia Ainsley, NBC.
Thank you for doing this. You said we are not done, and that Combs did not do this alone. Do you foresee that there could be other charges related to this case?
I'm not taking anything off the table.
Jeff
Fisher. What's the difference between the sex trafficking and promoting travel for the purpose of prostitution?
Well, there are different crimes with different elements settled. I think we should get into the nitty-gritty of the legal discussion right now, but the sex trafficking, we believe they're all serious offenses, but the sex trafficking conduct carries some significant penalties, and we are gratified that we were able to bring that charge. I'm not going to be able to get into that, but you can look it up. And yes, sex trafficking, especially when it involves coercion or force, is a very serious
crime. Good afternoon, Darla Miles, ABC 7 New York. Thank you for this press conference and for the details to questions. In context of this indictment and the information that was presented to the grand jury, are you able to clarify the number of victims? Specify the number of victims just for this particular indictment? And secondly, can you provide details about the alleged arson?
Unfortunately, I'm unable to provide either the number of victims. You are correct. We are intentional in saying multiple. The details of the arson incident are limited to what we have in the indictment and also the detention letter that we filed, which contains more details than the indictment does at various points. But we don't have anything more beyond that.
Are any of his accomplices or associates under investigation? And additionally, could he face any more charges?
So the investigation is ongoing. That means both as to him and to anyone else who we believe committed the crime with him.
Julia Papa.
Hi, good morning from 1010 Wins. Any indication that some of the women who were victims here were imprisoned in his residences? And did he have locations where he kept them, and did they were not allowed to leave? And also, he's indicted here, although there were searches and raids in LA, Miami, why in New York?
Well, I'm biased. I'm the U.S. Attorney in the Southern District of New York. I think that we have an outstanding track record of bringing some of the most impactful, sprawling, complex, difficult sex trafficking, human trafficking, labor trafficking, you name it. The Southern District of New York can do it, and so we're very proud of that. And so the scope and complexity of this investigation isn't something that we ran from. It's something that we embrace, and we will continue to do that. As to your question about whether he imprisoned anyone, all I can say is that, you know, I mentioned this March 2016 incident where something was caught on video where a victim was attempting to flee, and there was violence that was associated with it. That was at a hotel.
That's really interesting, Chris.
Thanks a lot. Does your office intend to seek remand or reaching a bill package? And if you're willing, how would you contrast this with the R. Kelly case in EDNY in terms of the elements? Thanks.
So, we will be seeking detention. We have filed a letter laying out our reasoning for seeking pretrial detention. I'm not going to be able to expand beyond what's in the letter, but it contains all of the reasoning, and it contains the law as well. There is a presumption of detention in a case like this, and we think staffing, I will say that this team, this group of AUSAs is incredible. Group has been working on this case around the clock, and they've had their hands full. Next question.
Good morning, sir. A Compt attorney said his client has been cooperative with investigators. He said that this morning is one of you. Whatever reaction to that.
I would just say this. I think that generally, and with increasing frequency, the word cooperative or cooperating has taken on tremendous elasticity and no longer really bears any relation to what the word means when we use it in a very specific context. So, responding to lawful process and the like does not qualify as cooperation when we use that term here.
Lexus, can you repeat that? Was there any discussion about Mr. Combs surrendering? I understand he was taken into custody at a hotel in Manhattan last night, and maybe that wasn't the plan. Can you elaborate on how that came about and why that was?
How he was taken into custody and when he is in custody right now, he's going to be appearing in court today.
Was there any discussion of him surrendering, given, you know, they claim he's cooperating?
last night, so we're not going to see the baby idol that we normally see with any of the defendants walking in off the street. But again, a 1 hour heads up is supposed to be arranged sometime later today. Persons in the
sexual assault, sex trafficking, narcotics, and gun possession, were rumors that those alleged victims were cooperating with federal prosecutors. And then last night, it happened. Sean Combs, music mogul, artist, producer, was arrested out in New York City. According to the case, was taken into custody last night by federal authorities at the Park Hyatt Hotel. He'd actually come to New York in anticipation of the charges. And this comes after a grand jury has indicted. That grand today, 14-page filing. Damian Williams, the United States Attorney for the Southern District of New York, charged Combs with 3 counts. Racketeering conspiracy, that's the first one. Essentially, that Combs operated a criminal enterprise that engaged in sex trafficking, forced labor, kidnapping, arson, bribery, obstruction of justice, that they used coercion, threats, physical, sexual violence, guns, drugs, large discussion about freak-offs when he would allegedly threaten more women to engage in sex acts with male commercial sex workers. He's also charged with sex trafficking of a victim by using foreign force, coercion, or fraud to have that person engage in commercial sex acts. And he's also charged with transportation of people for purposes of prostitution. And these are three very serious felonies that potentially you're looking at potentially 15 years to life in prison. That's what we're talking about here. By the way, as we sort through all these legal filings around Sean Combs, there's a lot to get into. Can I just take a quick second to tell you guys about something positive? Yeah, something that I think you're actually going to really love. Would you want cash back? Sexual abuse trial. Also represented me? No. Let me bring on right now Brian and Jay and Monaco. Thank you so much for coming on, Brian. Really.
Thank you for having me.
So, your reactions and what you expected?
How about a pro football game in the city of Dublin, a vision concocted by me, Jameson, and no one else?
You know, it was, and yet reading it took me back to the movie. It's quite stunning that he's been charged with a racketeering crime. You know, when you think of Freako, you think of a lot of things. You know, you should think of entertainers. But here we go. Rather staggering in terms of the accusations. You're talking about sex trafficking, you're talking about kidnapping, forced labor, and the like, and it's going to be a war. The charges couldn't be more serious. My guess is the government will seek pretrial detention, as they often do in cases like this. And he's got a really great lawyer, and he's going to be.
And we'll get to that pretrial detention, because that's what prosecutors are going with. But the racketeering rights you have, this idea that criminal enterprise. It's not like it's Sean Combs, LLC, you know, it's a group of people, right? And the idea was is that he was using a legal method to force women and men as well into these situations, and it's a combination of all of these underlying crimes, but the government is not proving, they don't have to necessarily, they're not charging him with kidnapping or forced labor, but it's the underlying crime part of criminal conspiracy. How tough is that to prove? I mean, we know R. Kelly in New York, in the federal context, was charged, was found guilty, sentenced to 30 years in prison. But how tough is that to prove?
You know, RICO has always been an amazing tool for prosecutors. describe it. And the government's got to prove two predicate acts in order for there to be a racketeering conviction. So they've got a hyper to prove that they've used the statute that time and time again has ensnared a lot of people, a lot of people throughout the country because of its breadth. It is extremely broad, but it is not without limits. And so talk to me about ways you think that you would defend against this, because these allegations are quite stunning. We dedicated a full episode to breaking down this indictment, but you have everything from this idea of all of these ways that he was using sexual violence and physical violence and intimidation against these people to do what he wanted. And I want to break down something for you. So in this separate letter from the prosecutors, to the judge, were they asking for his bail to be denied, not be granted pretrial release? I want to list some of the evidence that they say they have, because this indictment, although it's comprehensive, is a little bare bones. So they say the government has conducted interviews with over 50 victims and witnesses, many of whom saw or experienced the defendant's abuse. Many of those witnesses corroborated their accounts are similarly consistent with other types of evidence discussed below. The government only expects that number to continue to grow, given that the investigation, which is now public, is ongoing. The electronic evidence is vast. The government has sought to obtain numerous search warrants for such evidence, in addition to obtaining evidence voluntarily from certain victims and witnesses. Setting aside devices seized in connection with the defendant's arrest, the government has obtained over 90 cell phones, laptops, cloud storage accounts, as well as over 30 other electronic storage devices, hard drives, thumb drives, cameras, and surveillance systems. This electronic data comes from the defendant himself, as well as co-conspirators, victims, witnesses, and it chronicles much of the defendant's criminal activity as it occurs. So that feels really tough to defend, but what
you shut up.
Back in hearing the sex trafficking and interstate transportation. So,
laid out in this indictment.
Absolutely. Well, there are a few key factors to this indictment, to this suit, that makes it stand far and beyond, like, alone from all the others that he's been facing. The first is that all the other cases that he's been answering to in the last year, almost a year now, have been civil lawsuits, and this is the first criminal proceeding, the criminal case. And the second is that it is a RICO case. It really shows how this was a whole orchestrated effort. According to the allegations in the indictment, he's really being accused of riling everyone around him, corralling them, and directing them to do all of his bidding, to do things like procure drugs, procure commercial sex workers, taking sex workers over state lines, paying off certain people, setting up sets for these things, these sexual performance parties called freak-offs, and absolutely coercing many people around him to take part in it, enable it, or turn a blind eye in the midst of him harming many victims over the years.
Well, remind us how we got to this point, because this indictment paints Sean Combs as someone who is as dangerous as he is depraved. And just a year ago, he was standing in the middle of Times Square getting the ceremonial key to the city from the mayor of New York, Eric Adams.
Yeah, this has been an absolute flip of the switch on Sean Diddy Combs' career, legacy, his entire persona,